Hey everybody, just wanted to take this opportunity to welcome you all to our offices here in Durango, Colorado. It's Sunday morning. We had a great ski weekend with the Brandon Fuller team from Oklahoma City. We're here this morning in our Durango offices, out in our museum area, and we're going to have a little question and answer period here with the team and just discuss some of the things that are going on in their business lives and so forth, and also have a dialogue back and forth, hopefully to help you, each one of you out there, to build your business. We had a great weekend, a great ski weekend, sort of fun, I guess you could call it. We had a lot of laughs, a lot of great times together. I have with me Brandon Fuller, RVP Oklahoma City. We have Ricky, Tiffany, Chris, Mike, Liz, and Dion, our folks that participated with us. We had a few non-skiers, but they probably fared a whole lot better than the rest of us did over the weekend. We had a great weekend. We had about 12 inches of new fresh powder snow here in Durango. It was really a fun time. Brandon, you have brought folks to a ski weekend before, and you were up to Aspen with us a couple of different times. And tell us what you know, I'm going to ask every one of you the same basic question, so you can sort of be thinking about it. What does something like this do for you personally, and for your team as an organization going forward? Because I mean, we talked about a lot of things. We got politics, we got religion, and we got, you know, and obviously we talk a lot about business. But I mean, tell me just and tell the folks, how does something like this, you know, affect your team, not only in the short run but hopefully in the long run?
Absolutely. You know, I think first of all, we want to thank you for having us out. There's a lot of leaders in Primerica, but there's none better than you and your hospitality and inviting us out. And I think everybody that's listening to this, you have the opportunity to come out. He's having an open invitation, basically. All you got to do is email him and you can come out and bring your folks. And if you're not taking advantage of that, I think it's a huge mistake. But I came to my first ski retreat when I was a district leader, and what it did for me is it sold me the dream. And I think that's the number one thing that I'm hoping that these guys get from this weekend, is I think it opened their eyes to the bigness of what is possible in Primerica. And the other thing I think they're going to get, or they've received, is how down to earth you are. And you know, money and fortune and all that doesn't have to change, you know, the person that you are on the inside. And I think that's huge.
Yeah,
and
I think that is important. I think that you know, that's one of the things, and we're going to talk a little bit about this a little bit later, but I got a fax from Art this morning, or it must have come over the weekend here, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that. And I think that was one of the things that really early on impressed me about Art, is that, he was a coach. He was just like me, and very genuine and not, you know, very unpretentious. And I think that goes a long way, because people want to know that you're real. People want to know that, you know, you're just sort of just like they are.
Right.
And I appreciate you saying that, because I think it's very important, you know, for our leaders to see that and to understand that. But we do have a fun time, and we had a couple of great dinners, and you know, you shared some time with some of my family here in Durango. So we really, really had a good time.
Absolutely. And just for the record, we're the number one ski team to come out to Durango, so there's a challenge right there for everybody.
And then I was a little concerned, you know, when you told me you were going to bring a group from Oklahoma City, you know, to come skiing. You know, Richard Church brought a group up here last three weeks ago from Phoenix. You know, I was a little concerned about that. My concerns, by the way, were warranted with that group. But you guys really did good. I was really surprised you kept up with us. Chrissy over there on his snowboard, we had a few laughs. We'll talk about that a little bit later. But and then we probably should talk about that last run of the day sometime during the course of the the interview. But it was fun, and I appreciate you saying all those things. Let's pass it over to Ricky. Ricky, you're pretty new in the business, I guess, and not really an old timer at all. But how do you give us your impression of sort of everything that you saw here, everything that sort of took place here, besides the fun and games that we had? What are some of the things you were thinking about?
Well, I just for
us. And you're full-time right now, right?
Yeah, I just went full-time in September-ish.
Uh-huh.
And just, it's been really hard for me to get it kind of kicked into gear. And then seeing everything that you've got and everything that you've accumulated over the time just kind of opened my eyes to what I need to be doing. And then the little powwow we did in your living room and what you focused on really kind of put that into perspective for me and what I need to be focusing on.
Yeah, because in reality, the business itself, I always say this because I believe it, is that the basic fundamental platform from which we do our business really is fairly simple. It's not necessarily easy, but it's pretty simple. The mechanics have changed a lot from my time, but sort of, you know, why we're in business and what we're trying to accomplish, I mean, none of that really stuff has changed, and you have to see it for what it is, and you have to be willing to talk to the people, and you have to be willing to tell your story. But I know that a lot of people, they look at Primerica, and one of the things they think about is, well, it's too good to be true, it's a get-rich-quick scheme, you know, I can't see myself being a salesperson. But when I joined the company, Ricky, my first thing was, man, I saw this as a crusade. I saw this as, you know, really doing something special with my life and helping other people, you know, at the same time. And I tell people the reason why we're in the business we're in is there's three reasons. Number one, people have been taken advantage of, you know, by financial institutions, whether it's banks or insurance companies, you know, whatever like that. The second thing is that we found a way to, you know, to fix that problem through buy term invest the difference, the rule of 72, you know, all the things that we do and we talk about. And then the third thing is we found companies along the way that were willing to pay us a ton of money, Brandon, you know, to do this. And so that's really why we do what we do. And what we have to continue to do is try to impress upon people that we are different, we do things differently, we think differently, we act differently, and the results that we can achieve for people are different than pretty much what everybody else is talking about out there. Right. And so what I'm hearing you say is that some of the things that you're starting to see more of.
Right. No, definitely. I came from a bank when I came into the business, and I could see all the bank was trying to do was sell the customers more products to get them further in debt, loans, credit cards, all that stuff.
Yeah.
And then when Michael sat down with me to train me and show me the business, it just really opened my eyes then on what the banks and other institutions are actually doing.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah.
And then coming here, of course, like I said, it just pushed it to a new level.
Well, one of the things for me, I enjoy you know, meeting different people, and I enjoy, you know, hearing your stories, because what I find is that I can personally relate in many, many ways to all of you, because it's sort of been there, done that, sort of understand that, you know. And what it tells me is that there are a lot of people out there just like me that are hungry, that want to do something, want to be somebody, want to do something special with their life. They just don't have something out there right now that's given them that opportunity.
Right.
And here we have Primerica that really does, you know, make dreams come true. I mean, you got to work at it, but it really does make dreams come true. Tiffany, let's pass the microphone over to you. Chris and Tiffany are a young couple. Tiffany and Chris are expecting their second child, is that right? So Tiffany didn't get on the slopes with us this time, but obviously, Tiffany, this is your first sort of visit out to this part of the world. Tell us just, I mean, how you didn't get a chance to get out and watch us make fools of ourselves out there on the slopes, but you were able to sort of, you know, see what we do, how we do it, and sort of have some fun with this. Give us your impressions of this this weekend.
I think just kind of being at your house and seeing, kind of like what Ricky said, all of the stuff that you have and seeing how close you are with your family. And I kind of feel like I have to pick sometimes between my family or the business.
Yeah.
And seeing that you have both at the same time.
Because you're licensed, right? You're working as a couple. You're in the business, right?
Correct, yeah.
Yeah.
And so, for me, I struggle with leaving my 2-year-old at home and then, you know, having another one here shortly. I worry about how it may affect the business and just how people adjust in these stages of life and trying to build a career at the same time. And I think just being around you, I saw that, you know, you did have kids whenever you're building the business. They were pretty young. And then the fact that just because you're building a business doesn't mean that you sacrifice your relationship with your kids. Because even as adults, you can tell that you have a really close relationship with your boys and with your grandkids. And that's something that is big to me because I'm really big into family. So,
well, that's good. And I think that's important because a lot of people, Tiffany, use family as an excuse to not do the business or to just, you know, sort of give a half-butted effort, you know, towards it. And I say is that your family should be your reason, not your excuse. And for me, that was a big, big, big thing because I went full-time on June the 4th, 1973. Judd was born. He's obviously doing the taping here today. Judd was born 2 weeks later. And Krista, my oldest daughter, was just a couple of years old. And so, I mean, all of my kids are, you know, A.L. Williams, Primerica kids. I mean, everything they know, everything they see, everything they've done, everywhere they've been, has been a direct, you know, relationship or a direct result, I guess you could say, you know, of the business. And, you know, I value that. Just think about people that have, like you say, have to ship their kids off to, you know, daycare, or they got to ship them off somewhere, you know, after school programs. And, you know, and I promise you, Tiffany, I promise you, I saw my children when I was building this business more than the average dad saw their kids. I mean, I was the one that was always on school trips. I was the one that was coaching Little League. You know, I was the one that was, you know, taking them all. I was the one that was picking them up, taking them to school. And I mean, I think it needs to be your reason, not your excuse. Now, Chris, you're a police officer. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so you're part time in the business, and you and Tiffany are trying to build this together. And you're relatively new in the business. So tell us, you know, what's your impression, other than the fact that, you know, you're not sure you want to come snowboarding with us again next time.
I'm always down for snowboarding. The biggest thing for us at the time when Brandon came and sat down with us, I was skeptical, like a lot of others are, but I saw the opportunity to do something other than what I was doing at this, you know, present time. Our goal from the get-go when we became a family was I wanted Tiffany to stay at home and raise our children. And we've been able to do that, but once Brandon introduced us to this, it was so much more than that. It wasn't just, you know, be a low, middle-income family. We wanted to do more than that and for our kids. And so, you know, at this point in time, it's one of those things that Tiffany's kind of taking the lead, which is hard for me as a man, but she's taking the lead in this and is doing well and just trying to be there to support and do what I can and currently trying to get more involved into it and like I said, bring something to our family that the opportunity for our family to do better than what we're doing now.
Well, you know, Chris, the one thing that I constantly tell people is that I revel in the fact that we're different. I don't want to be mainstream. I don't want to be like everybody else. I want people to see. I like the idea that we're different, Brandon. That you know, we don't march to the same drumbeat as corporate America. That we are, you know, we are different, and we have a unique opportunity, not only to, you know, do wonderful things for our family, which I've been very fortunate to do, but, you know, we have the opportunity to do some great things for other people also. And Ricky, we had a conversation about that. Remind me when we come back to that. I want to talk about that. Okay. We had that conversation yesterday, but about being able to help people in a pretty unique way. But the fun part is you get to do things together as a team and as a family, and you can sort of run the show the way you want to run it, and that's a lot of fun. But coming to Durango like this, Chris, and coming up here with Brandon, who's obviously a character. I mean, we all know Brandon, okay? You know, and we've had a lot of fun, but there's also a serious side to this because you do get to see sort of a different side of what maybe your more narrow view there in Oklahoma City is of Primerica. Tell us, give us a sort of an insight to that.
I think probably the biggest thing that hit home with me was kind of like what Brandon touched on, was how down to earth you are and your entire family that we've met this weekend. Get to hang out with Judd and Russ and their kids as well. It's all about family, and that was a huge thing for me. Seeing somebody that has been in this since the beginning and has been as successful as you are, I didn't know what to expect, and to see that you still care about people that are Main Street people, and your family as well. That's really what hit home with me this weekend. And
well, I appreciate that, because I do think that is a huge, huge thing.
Absolutely. And seeing how people are taken advantage of in our own family, knowing what this company is doing to help others, seeing that personally take hold and seeing how we can help people is that's what
well,
really
I, you know, Chris, let me sort of segue off of that for just a second. I remember a time where I sat down with Art and Angela in their home, just sort of like we're here, you know, and that was the same impression that I sort of had of Art. I mean, here's this guy that I idolized, and he really was just like me. I mean, you know, and some of the I could tell you some stories that would you'd really laugh about the guy, but yet, you know, he just, it was all about family for him. You know, it was God, family, and business, and that's the way, you know, he structured the company, and that's the way it is today. And so it is. I love being different. I love that, you know, that we do take a different approach to things. And I certainly appreciate you and Tiffany being here, and obviously good luck with your coming child. Mike, you know, I had some interesting conversations with you along the way. You one of the few that actually beat me to the coffee pot every morning, which
really like coffee,
which is interesting because I'm usually the first one up with all my hounds to get the dogs out. But my first impression of you is that you've got a lot of insight into the business, and insight is great, Brandon, as we know.
Sure.
But I always tell people this business is all about how you feel and what you do about how you feel. And so give us your sort of thoughts on this weekend, you know, what you learned, what you saw, things that might have, you know, changed in your mind as you saw this, you know, having fun this weekend. And just give us your thoughts, because I do think, you know, my first impression of you is that you do have pretty good insight. And so I'd like to hear what you have to say.
Rusty, the biggest thing that I learned this weekend being around you and getting to know you was your freedom of time is something that we always hear about with Primerica leaders, but we don't get to spend a lot of time with you guys. And, you know, you make no decisions based on money. And a lot of middle-class families, you know, I was a teacher and coach and stuff, you know, all the decisions we make is based off of money. So the freedom of time that you have, and not just time, but time with your family, really impressed me. Because just about every decision that you made along the way, which was great, because I became really good friends with Judd there, a new fishing and hunting buddy, and Russ and stuff. And I look forward to getting to hang out with them more, you know, through the coming years. So that was something that we don't get to see every day. And in the decisions that you get to make based on how you want to live your life because of the way you built your business, was something that I learned a lot about. And that might not be a very big deal, but to me that was, because we don't get to see that, you know, every day in Oklahoma City.
Sure, sure. You know, it's interesting, again, Mike, that you say that, because one of the things that I'm always fond of saying, people ask me, you know, to sort of describe the business, if you will. And I always tell people, and this is sort of applicable to our weekend, Brandon, it's like pushing a snowball up a hill. And, you know, if you start with a, you know, little ball of snow and it gets bigger and bigger and bigger and tougher and harder to push, and you get it almost to the top of the hill, and that's when you really want to just sort of let go. And if you do, it's, you know, it's just all going to sort of crumble back on you. But once you get it to the top of the hill and you get it over, what happens? It sort of takes on a life of its own and just keeps going and going and going and going and going. And that's the way the business is. And so the key is two things. Number one, you got to start pushing. And number two, you can't give up until you get it to the top of the hill. And then, I mean, it's not fair to say it's something that happens by itself, but it almost does. You know, when you get to Rusty's position, it's pretty well, it almost happens by itself. But I appreciate, you know, what you have to say. Why don't you pass the mic over there? Okay, Liz and Dion, top recruiters, right? Is that correct, Liz?
Yeah.
You're top recruiters in Brandon's organization there. And you guys sat out the weekend, so you saw things from afar. So you might have a different perspective, Liz, than some of the other guys. Give us your thoughts on the weekend.
Well, I'm like everyone here. Thank you very much for having us up here. I was anxious to have won the trip because I have watched and read about you as one of the founders and thinking, how can someone stay with something so long? And you never hear the discouragement. But to me, in listening and watching you, you are the most down-to-earth person. And that, now I don't mean this disrespectful at all, but it really surprised me.
Well, good.
You know, because I've just watched you on stage. And
you also saw me walk around in my PJs, too. So.
Well, yes. That's pretty down-to-earth. But, I mean, you know, you really impressed me with your family. Your grandchildren are just totally awesome. Of course, I'm a grandma, so, you know, that's special to me. Uh-huh. But, you know, in the family part, you know, Dion, we've had some struggles with Dion's health. And Primerica family has been just such a – Brandon never missed a hospital visit. And I thought it was just in our base shop. But being here this weekend, I see it's the whole Primerica family. You know, when you're in Primerica, it's a huge family. It's
you're right.
You know,
right.
It's everybody cares about everybody, and for you to care about us is overwhelming.
Well, I appreciate that. Dan, give us again. You saw things from afar, okay? And I know you just sort of quiet, not really outspoken like some of the other folks here. Give us your thoughts as you sat back and watched.
Well, mostly I was observing you and just listening to a lot of the stuff that you had to say. One thing that I got out of this weekend, one statement that you made, to the victor goes the spoils. You know, so I see that over the years you've had a tremendous victory, but it came at a cost.
It did.
You know, it came at a cost. So people shouldn't assume that it's going to be easy, you know, and just seeing the bigness really solidifies your belief in the company, you know. And Liz and I, our goal is to be the one. You know, Brandon always talks about in your family, you know, who's going to be that one person that the family can depend on, you know. And Liz and I, we've assumed that role for many years, but our ability to help to the extent that we want to has been somewhat limited. But with Primerica, it can become unlimited.
That's true.
You know, it can become unlimited.
That's
true. And there's a lot of people that are out there hurting, and a lot of people are in our family. You know, so Primerica is the most logical and the best vehicle to use to get to where you want to be financially and also help other people.
It's true.
Also help other people. So it
gives
us a great opportunity for that.
What you're saying, Dion, because I am very fond of saying that this is the highest paid, toughest business in the world. It's also the lowest paid, easiest business in the world. If it was easy, now, as we were talking this morning driving in, it's relatively simple, okay? But it's not real easy. If it was easy, everybody would be doing it.
Right.
And if everybody was doing it, you know, the opportunity, Brandon, may not be as, you know, quite as great as it might be.
Sure.
So, you know, we can't mislead someone by saying, you know, this is a cakewalk, because you've all experienced the facts that it's not. I mean, you know, we're all going to have setbacks. We're all going to have to sort of readjust. We're all going to have to make, you know, changes and things. to make this thing work. Pass that mic back over to Ricky, if you would. I want to ask, and then what I'm going to do as we sort of close this in just the last couple of minutes, I want you all to think of a question that you'd like me to answer about the business, whether it's a prospecting or closing or recruiting or anything that might be on your mind. So I'll give you a few seconds to think about that. But Ricky, you were telling me about a situation that you had the other day, and I'd just like you to relate that to the troops out there, what we were talking about.
Right.
Go back and tell us about that story.
You're talking about the one where we sat down with my sister?
Yes.
Yeah, we sat down with my sister. It was my second training kitchen table appointment, and she has supported me from the very beginning with everything. Most of my referrals have come from her. And we sat down, and she saw how important everything was and saw how she could get out of debt. She didn't believe that she could because of how much she had in her income. And so Michael and I came up with the FNA, and we gave it to her and basically just said, you know, follow this and, you know, do step-by-step debt stacking, and you'll be good to go. And she called me, I think it was in August or September, so it hadn't even been a year yet that she had done this. She had already paid off four debts, and her credit score had gone up 40 points in just like 8 to 9 months.
See, now this is a critical point, because most people, when you sit down with them, and you've all experienced kitchen tables like I have, one of the very first things they think about, too good to be true, mm-hmm. you know, is this a scam? You know, are you guys for real? You know, does this really work, kind of thing? And so I think it's important, you know, I mean, and that's a story. If I'm you, Ricky, man, I would preach that to the rooftop, to everybody.
Right.
I saw.
Right.
Well, let me give you an example of what we've done.
Right.
You know, and it's your sister, so it's mm-hmm. not like, you know, and most, as you all know, most family are the most skeptical.
Right.
You know,
right. Of
okay,
course.
So you had the opportunity to get to your sister
right.
and really help her.
Yeah.
So that's a great story. When you start, and I mean, I'm not real up on all of this, but a 40-point jump in your credit score, Brandon, that's a big deal, isn't
yeah.
it? That's a big deal. So that's a fantastic story. Thank you, Ricky. So Brandon, what do you think? What's a question that or something that I could answer for you or maybe give you some insight to that can help you and also help our teammates
sure,
out there?
Sure, absolutely. I think the main thing for me, and I know a lot of people out there struggle with, you know, belief, and not in the company so much, but a lot of people that have struggled in the business, you know, it's their own fault they struggled.
That's true.
But they tend to lose belief in themselves that they can still make it happen. They know that Primerica works. They know that it can work for a guy like you or maybe a guy like me. But for them, getting them to believe, and I really believe there's two important dates in Primerica. The day you sign your IBA is crucial. But even more important than that is the day you decide to go win. How do you get to that decision and avoid the plateaus along the way? Because a lot of people, their goal is to get to 100 grand and then they stay there.
That's right.
I'm an example of that. And then there's other people that, you know, they get to 200 grand and they plateau.
You're right.
How do you avoid getting into that situation?
Well, that's a great question, by the way. And it's a question that Rusty Crossland has struggled with for the better part of 40 years. And I don't necessarily want to disappoint you, because there's no real answer to that. Because the answer lies, you know, basically within the heart and soul and mind of the person.
Sure.
But for me, it was an overwhelming, burning, driving, just decision that I wanted to be the best I could be, and that I didn't want to disappoint Art Williams. I wanted him to always think that I was a stud, that I was somebody that needed to, I mean, I was going to be always part of the inner circle. I was always going to be part of, you know, the guys he turned to. And his mentoring of me and his ability to get inside my heart, to get inside my head, and to make me feel better and bigger than maybe I felt that I was, mm-hmm. you know, kept me moving forward all the time. And competition is everything. And we had a great office, and you know, a lot of the legends of the company I was competing with, and so I think that drove me. But I think one of the things you have to do is eventually get to a point where your life has to become more than just you and your immediate family. It has to become, what can I do for my community? What can I do for society? You have to develop an attitude of being able to do something bigger than you. And you know, I mean, the sad part about it is, Brandon, I really don't have, you know, the answer, because everybody's different. But you are so right, and people just plateau, and they either it's they get tired, or they get satisfied. See, one of the things I would tell people, Rusty Crossland never is satisfied. You know, my motor's at red line all the time. Now, again, the older I get, and you know, the more I have the ability to be with my family and do that. I mean, I'm not quite as intense maybe as I once was, but I mean, it was just that. I mean, I would tell people that, you know, if you want to play marbles, you know, make sure you bring your best ones.
Right.
Because I'm going to get your best ones. You know, if we were flipping baseball cards, I want your Mickey Mantle rookie card to be one of the ones that I can get a chance to win. I just always was a competitor. And I think that is something, you know, that that you have to continue to work on. So not sure that that gives you much help in there. But I think it's just, you know, you got to be willing to compete. You got to think of something bigger than you, and you've got to drive through, you know, you got to drive through those thresholds and get to the next side.
Right.
Okay. Ricky, what are you thinking?
One of the things that I really struggle with in the business is the prospecting and turning those prospects into recruits. I've gotten pretty decent kitchen table because Brandon has created an awesome training system for us to learn, but the prospecting and recruiting part is just, I think it's my own wall that I have put up that I'm having a hard time mm-hmm. breaking through to get to that. What's the best way to just, I mean, just, I don't.
Well, a couple things. The most important thing is to recruit to recruit, mm-hmm. not recruit to sell. Mm-hmm. And if you get that mindset that recruiting is, you know, the forefront of what you're trying to do. I tell people every day that your biggest responsibility as a Primerica RVP or leader is to build successful people. Mm-hmm. It's not to be the most, write the most sales or do the most FNAs, which may end up being part of it, mm-hmm. but your responsibility is to build successful people. And my attitude always was, try it, you'll like it. Mm-hmm. You know, show and tell. Let me show you what to do, let me tell you what to do, and then you be the deciding factor. And I'd always come back to, you know, what do you have to lose?
Right.
You got a few hours, you know, let's go see. And what if I could make you, you know, $200 or $300 or $400? What if I could make you, you know, or, you know, help you, you know, pay your house payment or you know, pay your car payment and get you involved in a business that, and you don't have to be full-time. I mean, mm-hmm. you can earn while you learn. And maybe someday you'll see that you can make more money doing this than what you're doing on your full-time job, have more freedom, have more time with your family. And I would just keep pounding away at those things that Primerica does for people.
Right.
But I would always go back to, you know, try it. You know, you've got nothing to lose.
Okay.
And, you know, you've got a few hours. Let's go. Let me prove to you that this system works, and then you decide if it's something that you want to pursue into the future.
Yeah, that's good.
Tiffany, I already know what your question is.
What's that?
Go ahead. I won't. Oh, go ahead.
I actually, normally my question is about fear and just breaking through, like being afraid to talk to people. But I actually had another question for you. I know that you had given us earlier this weekend about like your monthly goals.
Uh-huh.
As far as like the 8 personal sales,
right,
and
eight,
the five
recruits.
Yeah,
right,
five
right.
recruits. In order to hit like the 5 recruits, I guess, you know, we have been focusing on prospecting and recruiting. And I do have a fear of speaking to people, but I'm trying to break through that. Was there a set number of people that you tried to talk to each day to prospect? I know that you had said you have to talk to everybody, but I didn't know, since I'm kind of OCD in structure, I didn't know if there's a set number that you focused on every day to hit that monthly goal of 5.
Okay, the long and the short, no.
Okay.
It's you have to talk to everybody, because you can never eliminate your market. You never know who the next superstar might be. And also, another important factor is the person that you may be talking to at that moment may not be ready to respond, but 6 months from now, their circumstances may change, and right. they may be ready. So you never eliminate your market. What I think you should do, and what I did, is I developed a simple approach. I didn't try to complicate things. I developed a simple approach, asking questions, you know, getting answers, and then trying to close for the appointment. And what Rusty Crossland did is he sold the sizzle of our business. He didn't sell. I just sold the aroma of the business. I didn't try to on that interview trying to get the appointment. I never tried to sell the, you know, the steak, the baked potato, the mushroom gravy, and the chocolate mousse after dinner. I mean, and the nice bottle of red wine. I never tried to sell that, all right? We had some good red wine this weekend. Okay. But anyway, I never tried to sell that. All I wanted to do was to whet their appetite enough for them to say, yes, come see me. Yes, I'll listen. And then at that point, it became, you know, salesmanship. You know, how well could I communicate to these people what we do, why we do it, how they could be involved, and what's in it for them. Because again, two things you got to remember. People buy Primerica products for two reasons, okay? It's not because they like you, although that's part of it. They buy on greed and they buy on emotion. They buy on the fact that someday they can have a lot of money, someday their family's gonna be well protected because you're gonna leave the wife a large estate, you know, with your insurance, you're gonna be able to get out of debt, blah, blah, blah. Or the emotion, okay? The emotion is, wow, I can do something special for my community. I can do something special for me and my family and the community, and they just buy on emotion. What you have to do is decide what factor you gotta focus on. And in order to do that, you got to be a good listener, not just a good talker. So that should help you, okay? Because you're a good listener. And you have to listen to what people say and then respond and react to what they say. And as I said, always ask a lot of questions. For me, I never missed an opportunity, any place, anytime, anywhere, under any circumstances. And trust me, Tiffany, Rusty Crossland was just like you. I mean, I remember, and this is a sort of an interesting little segue. I remember as a young kid, I had a newspaper route. Okay, this is a true story. I had a newspaper route. And every now and again, they would bring us, it was the Bergen Evening Record, which is in Bergen County, New Jersey, which, by the way, is where Jimmy Myers was born, okay, our great SNSD. And I was a paper carrier, okay? But every now and again, the guy that was sort of the manager would go into the Bergen Evening Record home office, and they had banks of telephones, okay, and they wanted us to literally cold call out of the phone book, you know, just go on down the list of the numbers and ask people, you know, if they got home delivery of the Bergen Evening Record. I mean, Tiffany, I could no more pick up that dadgum phone and call somebody. I mean, I was 12 years old or 13 or 14 years old. I mean, I was petrified of trying to talk to somebody about something, about anything like that, okay? Right. And so, I mean, I feel your pain. I understand, you know, how you feel. But over time, what I began to realize is that most people, you know, are nice. Most people, you know, they're gonna give you three answers, yes, no, or maybe. Two out of three, you know, is really good that I could work on. And so you just have to develop a simple approach that's not complex, that someone can listen to and say, tell me more. Right. So what you need to be thinking about is everything that you say to that client or that potential recruit needs to lead to tell me more. And if you're asking the right questions leading to tell me more, eventually you're going to get to the point where you're going to see their eyes change, their expression change, and you found their hot button, and then that's what you zero in on. But you got to continue to ask those questions, okay?
Okay, thank you.
All right, Chrissy?
I've seen, you know, there's a lot of driving factors, I think, in this business, and it's different for everybody. whether it is the finances or becoming wealthy or the family time, the freedom and all that kind of stuff. What was your drive through those plateaus to get you to the point that you are now?
Well, that's a great question, and it's really a very simple answer. Grew up really poor. My dad was a saloon singer. He was an entertainer. You know, didn't make a lot of money. You know, maybe smoked too much, drank too much at the time. It was sort of that the way it was back then. You know, my mother, we had four kids, so my mother really never worked. So it was a constant struggle. And I remember vividly, Chris, vividly, situations and circumstances where I was so embarrassed about the way I looked, the way I dressed, in comparison to my peers, and it just, I mean, I had such a bad self-image because of all that, and it wasn't really my parents' fault, I guess. It was just the circumstances at that point in time, and so when I was lucky enough to go to college, lucky enough to get a degree, lucky enough to do reasonably well in college, I got a decent job. I was able to become a head coach. I didn't make a lot of money, but that helped me along the way. And then when I saw, you know, A.L. Williams and Art that fateful day in October of 1972, I mean, it was bells, whistles, and fireworks. I said, this is it. Here's my chance. I can do this. I can see myself being much, much better, you know, than I could see me doing more for my family than my mom and dad could have ever done for me. And so that was a huge driving factor for me. And so, you know, I don't think you have to be, you know, like be poverty stricken to be motivated. But I know that for me, I never, ever wanted to go back to where I was. I always wanted to go forward and bring my family with them. You know, I do have a tendency of having a little bit of a Santa Claus complex. You know, I want to do things for my children. I want to give my children, my grandkids things. You know, but along the way, you know, I've also learned that it's important for them to achieve things on their own, and I've always encouraged that. So, I think to answer your question, I was just so broke. I mean, I just never wanted to go back there. And when I saw A.L. Williams, I saw this as the first real vehicle, and I looked at different things along the way, you know. I mean, friends talked to me about Amway and all that other sort of stuff, you know. And you know, I mean, I remember the head coach of I was an assistant coach at a high school in Atlanta, and I remember the first summer after that, he wanted me to get licensed and sell life insurance. If I remember correctly, it was Mutual of New York or one of those companies that hired coaches in the summer to sell life insurance. And I thought, oh man, throw up. The last thing I want to do is sell life insurance. I mean, I remember I pumped gas that summer. I worked at a gas station and pumped gas just so I didn't have to sell life insurance. Okay, so I was just of the opinion that whatever it was going to take for me not to go back to where I was in. So hopefully that helps you. Mike?
Yes, sir. I have a licensing question for you. The other night we had a great conversation in your Suburban about the licensing process and everything, and your goal was 5 recruits and 3 of those to get licensed every month, I think,
right,
is what you told me.
Right.
And I've never been that good of getting my people coded. So what kind of, what could you tell me to help me get, you know, if I get 5 recruits a month and to get 3 licensed, you know, what was your process to keep those people in?
Good question. Two things. Number one, it was easier then,
okay,
which doesn't help you.
Right.
It was just, there was no pre-licensing,
okay,
no PFSU,
yeah,
you know, no continuing education, none of that crap we got to go through today. But there was also another thing that sort of helped us along the way is that in Georgia early on we had temporary licenses. So if I got Brandon's hiring papers 7 days from now, he could go make a sale and get paid, okay? But that temporary license eventually ended. So what happened is if I got Brandon into the field pretty quick and he got a check, okay, he knew that if he didn't get a license, eventually, you know, that check was going to be gone. And also, you know, they were only advancing 75%, so he had 25% of his money sitting out there that if he didn't get a license, you know, he wasn't going to get. And so I think that the process today is much tougher, and you have to have a system to monitor that, and you have to have a system to make people accountable. So when so for us, you know, it wasn't that big a deal. For you, it's a big dadgum deal. Okay, so you've got to develop a system of keeping people accountable to you, staying in touch with them. Make you as the leader have to know when, you know, when to get them scheduled. Okay, you as a leader, one of the things that I would suggest that if I had somebody, you told me you had what, 15 people in PFSU?
13 people.
13 people in PFSU this weekend. If I had 13, if I was an RVP and I had 13 people in PFSU this weekend, I would be at that door and I would greet every single one of those people as they came in. Okay? And if there were only 8 of them came in, I would be on the phone with those other 5 ASAP, find out why they're not there.
Gotcha.
Okay, so not only do they have to be accountable, but you got to be accountable to them.
Okay.
And one of the things, again, that we tried very, very hard to do, Mike, is we tried to teach our people that sometimes leaders have to be obnoxious. Sometimes leaders have to be forceful. Sometimes you do have to, you know, call a spade a spade. You have to look at people and not come through the back door, but come crashing through the front door, okay? And licensing was one thing that we really, really, in fact, one of the things that Art and I talk about all the time is that his frustration. Now again, remember, as I said in the beginning, licensing was different back then, okay? His frustration is that just like you're saying, we're getting all these people through the front door, you know, and none of them are coming out the back. Mm-hmm. You know, they're hopping out the windows or going back out the front door, okay? And so I think the most important thing is having a licensing system and having them accountable, knowing where each one of them is along the way. And obviously, you know, that's how they get paid today, you know? And if you go out on whatever your guidelines are, Brandon, you know, if you go out on 3 field training appointments and see, you know, 3 clients, you know, you're the one that's getting, you know, getting the commissions on that. And they're just learning. They get their bonus. They get their $300 bonus or whatever. But at the end of the day, you want to let them know. And by the way, you know, if Mike gives Brandon, you know, 26 referrals and Mike craps out of the business, I guarantee Ned Gum to you, Brandon's going to go talk to those 26 people instead of you. So that's another motivation to make sure you get people out there going. But I think the most important thing is you have to be accountable to them just as much as they have got to be accountable to you. Liz?
Whenever you were the team leader on with your team, did you have personal meetings at your house with just your team?
Yes.
Or?
Yes. We did. We always had receptions, potluck suppers. We had, you know, beans and burgers. You know, hot. You know, we always made it to competition a lot of times. Okay, but we always had people over the house. We always had people sitting around, you know, talking the business early, especially early on in the business. I think that's very important because one of the things that I'm going to read here that Art sent me this morning is, you know, it was his game plan, which as you will find out, sort of sounds hokey, you know, and pretty simple, but obviously worked. Okay, and the last thing he puts on his game plan is relationships. And to me, and we've all talked about that, you know, Tiffany, about family, Mike, and Brandon, and how we're all sort of one family together. That was so important, you know. I mean, my children grew up with the Buisson kids, okay. My kids, my wife actually took in Bill Williams's, Art's brother. We actually took in his kids and babysat for he and Patsy. Bill's wife, their kids, and Lynn Mesereau, who you may know, works in the home office today. That's little Lynn. I mean, I changed little Lynn's diapers. Okay, she's, I don't know how old she is, right? She's probably Judd's age. She's got kids of her own. Okay, so that's very, very, very important. to build those personal relationships. Dion?
When the business got really, really tough, I mean, when you really hit a wall, what were some of the strategies that you used to fight through that particular issue?
Good point. Okay, a couple of things. Number one, Art always talked about the business will, sometimes you'll be in sort of in the depth of the valleys and you'll be at the top of the mountain. And the most important thing is the time that you spend in the valleys versus the time that you're sort of on the top. And one of the things Art always talked about is, you know, there's going to be peaks and valleys. Most important thing is just don't pitch your tent in the valley. Okay, let's just pitch your tent at the top. Did you have a follow-up to that? Or that? Okay, so two things. Number one, Art had a propensity to write personal notes. He still does. I mean, he hand wrote this letter to me, this note to me. And he would always send me things at the, just Brandon, at the right time. You know, he would send me something that would just lift me up and say, okay. Plus, you know, Primerica is a recognition company. And when I got really down, all I had to do was look on the wall. You know, and we used to tell our guys and gals that if you did it once, you can do it again.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Okay? What did you do the first time, you know, to get that plaque?
Mm-hmm.
Well, to me, it seems like if you want to get that plaque again or get better than that, you got to do something similar than what you did before.
Mm-hmm.
So I would always think about, okay, how did I overcome this before? What did I do before? And Art always said one thing that made such a huge impression, and Brandon, I know you've heard this before, said, you're one recruit away from
an explosion.
So if you're down the dumps, he would always say, if recruiting slows down, okay, go prospect for sales, and your recruiting will go up. If your sales are down, go prospect for recruits and your sales will go up. So when sales are down, recruiting's got to be up. When recruiting's up, you know, or down, your sales have got to go up.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a matter of just not, if not A, feeling sorry for yourself, B, you know, deciding where you're at's where you're at. That's the worst attitude you can have.
Mm-hmm.
And part of the problem with our society today is that most people, where they're at's where they're at.
Yep.
And they just believe, well, there's nothing out there for me. You guys have to change that. And you guys have to have the opportunity to do that. Any last follow-up things that anybody has come up with? Because we're sort of close to the end of our time here. Anything, Brandon?
Just one last thing. I remember years ago, a very successful business person told me that if you have a plan and you work your plan, your plan
will
work.
That's
exactly.
Right.
And that successful businessman was you. And I think at this time of the year especially, everybody has reviewed their goals and looked at 2013 and adjusted for 2014. And we wanted you to know that we have put the plan in place, but we are totally dedicated to executing the plan, which I think is where most people mess up. And we're going to fall off the horse sometimes. You know, this is the time
sure.
of year where people, you know, they eat healthy, and then this is the time of year they fall off the wagon. And it's important to get right back on. And,
right.
and coming out this weekend has just even strengthened our commitment,
well,
I
good.
Think. And so
well,
it's awesome.
Well, good, Brandon. But, you know, I have to warn you. I mean, you're going to be on permanent TV here.
I know. That's why I said it.
Okay.
That's why I said
okay,
it.
Okay, so the monkey's on your back.
That's how we like it.
There. Well, from my point of view, it's been a great weekend. I've enjoyed getting to know all of you. It's going to be fun to sort of watch, Ricky, you know, where you end up on the mountain of Primerica, excuse me. But the one key is that is you can do this. There are a lot of people that have blazed the trail before you. You just got to do what we always try to teach our teammates, and that's the FTYBR system. And that simply stands for, you know, follow the yellow brick road. And when you follow the Primerica yellow brick road, you find the magic of Art Williams. You find, you know, and I always tell people, it's so important that you've got to do this business, you know, based on the gospel according to Art. And here's a primary way to sort of segue into that. I got this morning. Actually, I don't see the date on here. It was probably over the weekend, but I got this from Art. And I talked to Art last week, and we were talking about a bunch of things, and I faxed him something, I don't know, Wednesday or Thursday, and I got this back from him, and he titles this The Early Days, and he says, "What I did every day." And let me just read this to you real quickly. There's seven or eight things on here. He said, number one, I showed up for work every day. Sort of seems obvious, right? Totally positive all the time. Never changed my game plan, which I find really interesting, because if you know Art, his original game plan was to accumulate $300,000, because he figured at 10%, that was $30,000 a year for the rest of his life. And at that point in time, in those late 60s, early 70s, I mean, $30,000 the rest of your life was a lot of money. So Art never changed his game plan. Number four, he said he led by example. And his examples were, always had the most field training appointments, always made the most sales, always had the most recruits, and always made the most money. Now that, to me, is what leadership's all about. Okay, then number five, he identified studs and worked with those guys and gals. Okay, and then number six, which is not as necessarily applicable today as it was back in the day, killed cash value, killed prudential. All right, had a crusade. All right, and then last but not least, as we talked about, built relationships. So not too bad a game plan in my mind. And by the way, you know, other than he's not talking about going out and, you know, being a salesman and writing a lot of life insurance or mutual funds. So great lesson there. I really want to take this opportunity, you know, guys, to thank you for being here. It was a great fun weekend getting to know all of you and having some time. And surely we can't close this program, Brandon, without at least one ski story of sorts. And I'm sure we have a combination. We'll sort of end it on that. And do you have a ski story?
Sure, absolutely. Number one, I just want to remind everybody that we are, according to everybody this weekend, the best ski group that's ever come out.
That is true.
To Colorado.
That is true. That is true.
And there are no mountains in Oklahoma, so snowboarders. But for the record, the very last run, Rusty had already gone back home, and we're skiing with Russ and Judd. And Russ wants to take us on a signature course for Durango. And so we said, yeah, a signature slope. And so we're like, yeah, let's do it. He did not tell us it was a double black diamond, you know, deal, which is brutal. But just for the record, the worst fall of the weekend was by Durango's own Judd Crossland, okay? And I wish we had it on tape. We don't, but it will always be ingrained in my memory. That was my definite ski story for the weekend.
Anybody have a comment on that? Mike, you got you there, right?
I have a comment on that because I actually didn't see it. I was down probably at the middle part of the mountain with Russ, and I was looking off the slope just admiring how beautiful it was, and Russ was looking up. And all of a sudden, I hear Russ go, "Oh, dang, Judd just busted hard, and there goes a ski." And he goes, "That looks like he looks like he's hurt." And then all of a sudden, he just looks down at his watch and goes, "Hey, dude, I got to go pick up my kids. I'll see you later." So we went from, "Dadgum, my brother just got hurt," to, "I
got
to run."
Judd's
got
to get him.
Okay, so I'm sitting here with Brandon, right? And I'm hoping I'm in the frame. I'm sitting here with Brandon, and I'm not going to lie, he's struggling just a little bit. You know, it was the last run of the day, our legs were noodles, and I'm right above, and I'm like, Brandon's looking at me, he's like, go ahead and go. I was like, no, I need to kind of hang out and wait for you. He's like, no, go ahead and go. And I looked at him, and I was like, Brandon, you're first generation of my dad, right? And he goes, yeah. I was like, I better stay, you know, just to make sure. He's like, no, I'll go, I'll be fine. So I'm like, all right, cool. So I turn, point my skis down the hill, go no more than 2 feet, and plant my skis into a huge powder bump and just face plant into the slope. And that's when Russ was talking to Mike here about, oh, I just took a bad fall.
Yeah, well, you know, I mean, for all of you out there that are thinking about coming out, okay, we don't necessarily do that. You know, you can, you know, Rusty's a cruiser. By the way, would you agree I was last down the hill every time, pretty much.
But absolutely the most graceful.
That's right.
Brandon's bucking for a promotion. But hey, folks, it's great to have the opportunity to share with you. Hopefully you've learned something. Again, thanks, guys. Take your time. Drive home.
Thank you.
Safe.
Thank you.
And we'll do this again sometime. Yeah, God bless all of you. Thanks, guys. Take care. Thank you.